Well, first of all, I want to do a couple of thank yous. I want to thank the Lord Jesus, first of all, for giving me desire and even somewhat the ability to preach. I want to thank Pastor Mike for allowing me to do it. I want to thank Andrew, wherever he went, there he goes, for providing worship services that are not entertainment. They're, as a Christian, if you can't worship God, I think you're in serious trouble. Because are you going to like heaven? I mean, just stop and think about it for a minute. If you don't like church and worshiping, I don't think you're going to like heaven as much. I mean, if it's a 24-hour worship service, you know, it might not be for you. And I want to thank Dean and his crew for always being so gracious in helping me, for Patty, who always sets up everything for me. You've noticed that I don't have a laptop. You know, most of the guys that speak up here have laptops. Well, some of them have. When I first got my smartphone, my kids asked me who was going to run it for me. I have learned a couple of things. You know, there's a lot of things I don't know, but there is one thing I do know, that this book is the book. It is the book. There's no other book like it. It is the Word of God. It is God. It is Jesus. It's everything that we need. So today we're going to talk about abiding in that Word, because we live in a time, well, any time would have always been the time to live and to abide in the Word, to hang with Jesus. You know, we think more about it this day because we got 24/7 news coverage of what the devil's doing. And he's busy, but so is God. And we have the upper hand. But we also have to abide in the Word. We got to do our part. You know, what is the biggest little word? It's two. It's called if. Two syllables. If. Our whole life revolves around if. Sometimes positive, sometimes negative. If I would have done that. If. And God says, if you do this, I will do that. So today, on your bulletins, how many have a bulletin? If you don't, you should. You need one. On the back, our scripture is John 15:7, and it says, abide in my words. So I looked up what abide means. It's kind of different than what I thought it was going to be. I thought abide meant kind of like hang out with, and it kind of does that. But it says to obey, observe, follow. Now we're talking about scriptures now. Keep to, hold to, conform to, adhere to, stick to, stand by, act in accordance with, go along with, respect. There's a couple more, but so every time we see a scripture, this is what we need to do. If we're going to adhere to it, we're going to obey, if that's what it calls for, observe. This message today didn't really start out to be what it's going to be, but it's going to be basically every man a warrior. I mean, it just kind of morphed into that, if that's a proper word. And the reason I think I'm just going to go down that road, because I think the Lord wants us to, but it's just basic stuff. But it's basic stuff everybody needs to know. And I've got four warriors that are going to help me today. I only got three of the four original warriors, and I got one new warrior that's in my class, or my group, I should say. So if you went through the warrior class, just stand up, please. Only one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. So anything I say today, if it doesn't make sense to you, ask one of these guys. The only one that's not here, that's one of the original four, is Jan Kopich. And so he wasn't going to be able to help me out today, so I asked Scott Christensen, one of the new guys, to help out. We're going to go through four main scriptures and with sidetracks. But I think as a born-again Christian, you need some certain foundation things. If somebody comes up to you and, I mean, we live in a day and age, what if they put you on trial and ask you to prove you're a Christian? Could you? How many scriptures could you quote? In our course, we've memorized, I think, over 30 scriptures, because some of them were more than one scripture per night. And so we have them in us. I don't probably can't quote them to you all right off hand, well, I'm supposed to be able to. But there's some that's going to stick to me. There's one. I'm going to share just the one before I get started. It was one of our memory verses about halfway through, and we was talking about relationships. And it says, "It is my privilege to show my love for Jesus by caring for my wife, to love her, try to understand her." Always like that part. "But to give up my life and my rights for her." That was powerful. I will never forget that verse. Of all the 30, that won't be the one that sticks with me. Not that I always be able to accomplish that, but I'm working on it. And the last couple weeks, Sydney and I have been working on, I'm embarrassed to say, gossip. I mean, that's a tough one. It is so natural. It is so natural. I don't know why. It's just there. You know, and I give her the look. Generally, she gives me the look. But when we're driving, she motivates the car with her finger. Wherever she wants me to go, the finger tells me. So in the gossip, we have this look we give. And then in our house, when we say, whatever, that means it's over. We're not going down that route any further. So our first scripture for the day, where's Ron at? Oh, you got, Joe's going to run the microphone? Oh, there he is. Bob Barr Sr. is going to quote our first verse for us. He's a leader, so hopefully he gets it right.
Me too. Matthew 22, 36 to 38. "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. That is the first greatest commandment." Matthew 22, 36, 38.
Amen. And in that course, you have to say the address before and after, or you don't pass. How is that possible, to love the Lord thy God with all your mind, all your soul, and all your heart? How is that possible? I think the first thing that I had to do was I had to realize that I was actually a real live sinner in need of a Savior. I don't think you can go too far down the Christian route without realizing that you were actually a sinner headed for hell, whether you believe it or not, whether you liked it or not. You actually were headed for hell if you didn't have a Savior to stand in the gap for you. I think that's foundational. You have to have that knowledge of the fact, I really was a sinner. I may be a nice person, but you know, if you break one thing of the law, you break the whole law. I mean, if you ever told a lie, just even one little one, you're guilty. And when Jesus and the Father, before foundation of the earth, which is amazing to me, they sat down and figured it all out. They knew what would happen. They knew man would be man, and that his sin nature. I've yet to figure out, though, how Adam and Eve did that. They didn't have any influence except for one snake. They walked with God in the daytime, and he only told them one thing not to do. So where did their sin nature come from? They didn't have one yet. I've had yet to have anybody explain that to me, how that happened, why it happened. But as we all know, it did happen. So to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul. You know, in our scriptures, there's five things that we're taught to do. When you read a scripture, you are to say, look at it and say, is there a command to obey? And in this scripture, there's a command, isn't there? To love the Lord with all you. That's a conscious decision. It doesn't happen automatically. In fact, I've come to the conclusion, nothing in your spiritual life is automatic. You don't get saved automatically. You don't get close to the Lord automatically. You don't do anything automatically. You have to make an effort to press in. You do. Second thing you look for is a promise to claim. We all need promises. Because if you're looking for the world to solve your problems, and you're looking for the Democrats or Republicans to solve your problems, you're in sad shape. They don't have the answer. There is only one answer. You know, all, if you're from Hollywood or if you're in the Miss America pageant, what are you always for? World peace. That's their big thing, world peace. There's only one Prince of Peace that will ever make that possible. Until Jesus comes, there will be no peace. Sorry. We can have peace within ourselves, but the world as such will not know peace until the Prince of Peace comes. You know, I didn't understand how do you pray for the priests of Jerusalem? I've heard that my whole Christian life. Pray for the priests, the peace of Jerusalem. Well, then I heard somebody say, you pray for the Prince of Peace to come when he comes to Jerusalem. That's when the peace will show up. He's an amazing, amazing man, isn't he? Okay, our second scripture. Where's our microphone at? Oh, there he is. Scott Christensen. Pray for him so he gets it right. No pressure.
2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17, for all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17.
Right on. The only beef I have with every man or warrior is they don't use King James. Because everything I have memorized is in King James. So it's hard for me to learn some of these things because it's just contrary to what's right. All scripture, that means everything in here is good for four things. Teaching. If you need to know about God, this is the book. You can go by other people's experience, but it's better to get it firsthand, isn't it? Because what you need is that personal revelation whenever it comes. I mean, you can hear the same scripture for years sometimes, and then all of a sudden the light will go on. You need that personal revelation that you get. You got to have it. I mean, you got to have it to be saved. The Holy Spirit will bear witness with your spirit. When you have that realization, nobody will ever be able to take that away from you. You know, they talk about taking prayer out of school and all that. They can do that. They've done that. But they can't take this out of here. But what's the key? It's got to be in there first. It's got to be in there. So you have to memorize scripture. You have to be in the word. It's just part of the deal. Now, our last memory verse was, all authority has been given to me. So I looked up the word authority. What it means? It means the right to be governed. If you're going to be a Christian, you're going to have to allow the Lord to govern you. We don't always like that. I don't always like that. We're not used to being told what to do. We don't like being told what to do. But if you're going to be a Christian, you have to allow God to rule you. You just do. It's part of the package. I mean, it's a package deal. You just can't take some of it. You have to take it all. Second one is rebuking. It's better to allow the word to correct you than circumstances. The word of God has all the answers. It has all the questions. But if you need to be straightened out, let the Lord do it. Let the word do it. And of course, you have to be in the word in order to allow that to happen. Correcting, kind of the same thing. Correcting. And we got prisons full of people that need corrected. But we choose to let the word correct us. It's just easier. It's a lot easier to read the scripture and do what it says. Another one of our memory verses. Do not only hear the word and so deceive yourself, but do what it says. You have to do what it says. If, God says if. And the last one, training in righteousness so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. There's another scripture that says, you know, I want to be a workman that need not be ashamed. How many of you went to see the movie God's not dead, number two. And the guy came in and said he had 147 questions. How many of us could answer 147 questions about the Word? I can't think of 147 right offhand. Anyway, but are you thoroughly equipped if somebody challenges you? I had some Jehovah's Witnesses knock on my door the other day. Fortunately, I was busy, and I'm just the type that I stay there and talk to them. And the lady started out with John 3:16. It amazed me. She did, but she did. And of course, I said, you know, I'm a born again Christian. We got it all together. I don't have time for this at the moment. But what I should have said, when I walked back in the house, I should have said, well, what do you think about John 3:3? It would have been a obvious and potent comeback. What do you think about John 3:3? I missed it. But that wasn't the first time I missed it. But we need to be thoroughly equipped, trained in righteousness, right thinking, right living, right everything, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Find Joe Klemeth, please. There he is. He's got his own microphone.
I've got the third verse. It comes from Joshua 1:8. He says, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Joshua 1:8.
Amen. What's meditate mean? It means a lot of things, but it means deep thinking. Deep thinking. Meditate on the word. I got a good word picture that I like. It's, how many of you know about it? Horses and cows. A horse stands around all day and eats. That's all he does, for the most part. A cow will go eat and then go lay down and chew the cud, bring it back up. It's just grass and water. Recycled grass and water. Well, it is. That's what we need to do with the Word. You go read it, and then you meditate it. You know, in every man and warrior, they teach you how to have quiet times where you have two or three scriptures a week, whatever is your thing. You meditate on them until it becomes real to you. When the devil knocks on your door, what are you going to answer with? You going to answer with the Word, or are you going to answer with circumstances? You have to have the Word inside of you. It's your only way to ever win. It just is. God put it there for us to use. Meditate in it day and night, all the time. Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Out of the abundance of your, heart, your mouth will speak. You don't have to be around anybody very long to figure out where they are, what kind of a person they are, because it's an automatic thing. Your mouth will give you away. It just will. It may not the first day. It's kind of like when you're dating. You're on your best behavior. You're on the A game. But sooner or later, your mouth will give you away on what you really are. It's an automatic thing. I've proved it, so have you. In your heart. So how do you have the A game? You put this book in your heart. Amen. That's what Christians do. It's just what we do, isn't it? You put this word, the living word, the word that's sharper. It's quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides. It divides. Is there a baby around there? There is. The dairy baby. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. That's a good one. So that you may be careful to do what it says. And why do we want to do what it says? First off, we all want great lives. I mean, if you don't, you're lying. Everybody wants the good stuff. We do. We may not like the process that we're going through to get to the good stuff, but we all want the good stuff. We all want money, plenty of it. I did hear a guy the other day say something that I really liked. And he says, I don't believe in the prosperity gospel. But he said, I don't believe in the poverty gospel either. He said, what I believe in is the provisional gospel. God will provide. That's the best thing I've ever heard in that area. God will provide. It's a provisional gospel. Not only money, but whatever you need, God will provide. Because in my personal opinion, and it's right, is I think that God's whole existence is about us. I really believe that he spends no other time doing anything but thinking about us. Now, if there's other life form out there, it could be, I don't know, don't care really. But I know Jesus only died for us. He can only die one time. And it was important that he died for us. It put us back into right standing where we were. Because nobody wants to die in their sins. It's an automatic ticket to hell. We don't hear much about hell anymore. But when I was considering becoming a Christian, you couldn't have scared me with hell. I wasn't scared. After all, I was a good person. Hadn't killed anybody. Only stole a little bit of gas. Car was out of gas. Sad part about that was I had money. I don't know why we did it. I guess so we'd get away with it. Whatever. An unborn-again person does. That's what. My only defense. I always admire the Apostle Paul. He says, I have wronged no man. That is an amazing statement. After all he did to the church, for him to stand there and say, I have wronged no man. That's what a born-again experience will do for you. It gets your thinking back right again. I mean, how can he say that? Because he said what God said about him. And that's what we need to say. Our last scripture for the day. Where is he at? He's right there. Mark Anderson. I didn't know there was two of them, but there is.
Yes. Proverbs 18:21. The tongue has a power of life and death. Proverbs 18:21.
Amen. It does. Your tongue has the power of life and death. In our course, we learned about what we said about other people, what we say about our kids, you know. What are you speaking into your kids? What are you speaking into your wife? What are you speaking to anybody? Words have power. I mean, the old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. Yeah. When does that ever work for anybody? Words do have power. They do. Almost everything God did, he did with words. He spoke it, and it showed up. I mean, you know, they talk about the Big Bang Theory. I'm sure it was. It could have been a Big Bang when God says, let there be. You know, it could have been a Big Bang. It could have been a Big Bang. When Bob taught the class on science, way above my head, but I did enjoy it. It was way above my head, but I did enjoy it. The things that God did to create this earth and the things that have happened since then and everything about it, he's an amazing God. He just is. But I want to go on the other side of that. What are you saying about yourself? What do you say about yourself? Are you saying what God says about you? Or are you saying what the devil says about you? Because your words will destroy you just as easy as they will destroy somebody else. Or your words will build you up just like anybody else. You got to have words. And we all have words. Everybody has. Women have 25,000 a day. Men have 6 or 7. I don't know. That's just what Dr. Dobson says, and I believe everything he said. I miss him on the radio. I do. So we all have words. What are you going to do with your words? What are you going to do with your words? The tongue can set everything on fire, can't it? It can. I mean, what are you saying about this church? What are you saying about the people in it? Are you gossiping? I can say that because I'm guilty. You know, you can always preach the hard stuff when you're guilty. And we're just about always all guilty. You know, what is there about, we're supposed to have the new nature. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in us, makes alive our mortal body. So how's it even possible for that to get in there? We're just not renewed enough, are we? The Bible says you have to renew your mind. There's only one way to renew your mind, with this. That is all. Because your spirit, man, only responds to this. Remember, you're a three-part being. Your spirit is born again. It's as good as it's going to get. But then the Bible says you have to retrain your mind. You've got to renew your mind. Why? It needs washed. People say, well, you Christians are brainwashed. That's right. We need to be brainwashed. You've got to get the old thinking out and get the new thinking in. Because there's coming a time, well, could be today. For people die today, the rapture sound or the second coming, whichever you believe in, I don't care. But for the people who die today, that's today. All the chances to receive the Lord Jesus is on this side of your last breath. Once you take your last breath, it's too late. It's over. You're going to realize it's too late. When you stand before God, I mean, I was just reading a book the other day that I found in the library, actually, about a guy that went to hell and came back. And his description of hell was, it's hard to even imagine that. Of course, it's hard for me to even imagine heaven. It's hard for me to imagine eternity. That's a long time. What are we going to do for a whole eternity? Yeah. Isn't that going to get old, though? It shouldn't. It's not supposed to. And in that area, you're not going to have any hindrances. You know, there will be no flesh to deal with. It'll just be pure heaven, I guess, is the best way to do it. So your tongue can either, you can either speak the words of God or the words of the devil. The devil goes around about doing what? Seeking whom he may devour. We don't want to help him devour anybody. So we're all going to make a conscious effort today, starting. We're not going to gossip anymore. We're only going to speak words of life, not words of death. How many of you seen Josie Wales? At the end, when he meets 10 bears, and 10 bears says, "By the words of life," and Jesse says, "Josie," not Jesse, Josie says, "My words of life are in my gun. It's words of life," and they said, "It will be life." You know, we talk about before church when God says, "This day I set before you, blessing, cursing, life and death. Choose life." The sad part is he had to tell us to choose life. We shouldn't even have to be told to choose the good stuff. For some reason, he knew we needed it. So in recapping, we're going to abide in the Word. Let's everybody pick up their bulletin. I believe in participation. We're going to read the definition. Ready? Obey. Observe, follow, keep to, hold to, conform to, adhere to, stick to, stand by, act in accordance with, go along, and respect. This book definitely needs to be respected. It's not something to lay on your counter. It doesn't do any good just to lay there. It doesn't do any good even if it's open. It's got to be put in here, because what comes in comes out. Stinking thinking in, stinking thinking out. How many of you ever been in Amway? You know, whether you think about it or not, they taught some awful good principles. They did. But they got it all out of the Word, if you've ever noticed. Everything good comes from this book. Everything. There is nothing bad comes out of here. So also, we are going to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, are we not? Okay. We're going to let the Word be useful for teaching us, rebuking us, correcting us, and training us in righteousness, so that we'd be thoroughly equipped for every good work, are we not? We're not going to let this book of law depart from our mouth, but we're going to meditate on it day and night. Day and night, so that you will be careful to do everything written in it, then you will be prosperous and successful. And then the last verse, the tongue. Grab hold. Your tongue decides the course of your life. It can also help decide the course of other people's lives. And we've all been guilty of saying things that we wish we could grab back. But once it comes out, it's out. You can't get it back. So, your first assignment then is everybody's going to say, I've done a good job today. Aren't you? Just kidding. Just kidding. I don't want to impress you. Neither do I want to depress you. What I want is for the Lord to be able to move in your heart, in my heart. You know, when Andrew puts together a worship service, it's not for entertainment. Worship brings you into the position for the Lord to minister to you. It does. You know, and everybody worships. I mean, when you see these people go to concerts, they all standing up. Worshiping a guy on stage that's more likely going to overdose. And here we have the one that created the universe that lives inside of us, gives us new life. We can take time to worship him. We can take time to raise our hands. It's maybe uncomfortable as it is, especially if you came from a mainline background. Fortunately, I came from a Pentecostal background, so they did everything. Scared me the first couple times I heard somebody speaking in tongues. I didn't have any idea even what it was. Never even heard of it. Doesn't scare me now because of what the Holy Spirit does. You know, Jesus said, it's better that I go away than the Holy Spirit come. Amen. Don't ever say nothing ugly about the Holy Spirit. If you don't understand things, it's just better to be quiet. Don't ever say tongues is of the devil. You could be in serious trouble. You know, it is in the Word, and it's one of the things that we can use. And God has a purpose for it, and along with all the other gifts. You know, they're all designed for our profit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. It's for our profit. Everybody likes profit, don't they? Amen. So has everybody got it? No more problems? You're going to hang with God, aren't you? You're going to bide in the Word. And what makes this possible is the amazing grace that is extended towards each and every one of us. Where's my amazing grace guy and my two girls? Ever since Pastor Mike has allowed me to preach, I've wanted my wife and Robin to sing this song for me. It's called Amazing Grace. The only thing is today they're going to sing it in Cherokee. Their grandpa was Cherokee Indian. So they're going to sing it in their native tongue. Enjoy.
Yeah. joy.